Hey guys, we just finished the Church of the Eternally Secure a minute ago, and Hendrix, our super mod, asked me to do another video on turning the grace of God into lasciviousness, so I said I would. So the first thing we want to do when we untwist this is find out what the verse is not saying, because a lot of people try to say this means if you're saved and you sin, you're turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. Now, lasciviousness means sensuous, sinful behavior. It usually has a sexual connotation to it. So that's what the verse says. Let's read it. It's over in Jude. Before we go there, let's begin this with this verse in Romans 3:8. And not rather, as we be slanderously reported, as some affirm that we say, let us do evil so that good may come, whose damnation is just. So those of us who trust only in the finished work of Christ, who believe that his death, burial, and resurrection, his blood shed for us, is the only reason we're cleansed. It's the only reason we have the righteousness of God. We have it by faith, not our own righteousness based on works, not how much or little we sin. But it's all based on what Jesus has done for us. We are slanderously reported, as some affirm that we say, let us do evil so good may come, as if we go promoting sin. But no, we set the foundation, the only foundation that can be laid, and that is Jesus. And until you've trusted what he's done for you alone, you won't have the Holy Spirit, and you'll continue to think. You will continue to think that freedom means, ooh, we can sin all we want, not seeing sin as captivity that we're supposed to be set free from. So that's the first hint to me that you're still in carnal thinking, because sin is bondage, and nobody thinks it's freedom once they're saved. All right, so let's go over to Jude. We're going to read the whole chapter so we can look at the context about turning the grace of God into lasciviousness. Now, let me tell you, he's talking about false preachers that try to preach law and corrupt the gospel, which is what? That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried and he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. And because of that, we have eternal life. That's what saved us. So Jude is telling us to contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints, and he's coming against those that promote work salvation. Let's look. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father, that means set apart and made holy by God, and preserved in Jesus Christ and called. Who preserves our salvation? God. Who keeps us saved? God. He's the author and finisher of our faith. It's not about us. Okay, I'm sick of people saying you can lose salvation. The Father's not giving Jesus someone he's going to lose. He knew us from the foundation of the world, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. Okay? It says right here, preserved in Jesus. Mercy unto you and peace and love be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation of Gentiles and Jews, for everyone, every human being, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. What is that? The gospel. What Jesus did for us. All right? Judaizers are coming in. And this is Jesus' half-brother, trying to come in and corrupt the message. For there are certain men crept in unawares. Why are they unaware? Because they're pretending to be believers, okay? Who were before of old ordained to this condemnation. Ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. What it does not say is they're using the grace of God as lasciviousness. That's not what it's saying. They turn the grace of God into lasciviousness. They say, no, not grace. It's grace plus the law, which means we know it can't be grace. Because if it be of works, it's no longer grace. Grace is unearned, unmerited. It can't be grace and law. But they turn the grace of our God into lasciviousness. They call it, well, it can't be grace alone. You've also got to have the law, or people will just go wild, and then they'll put restrictions. All right, so they'll turn God's grace into lasciviousness. It's not that they're using his grace as lasciviousness. as a license to sin, as they say. Oh, I'm saved. I'm just going to sin away. He's not even talking about that. He's talking about false teachers calling God's grace some lascivious thing. As if we who are slanderously reported, go ahead, sin away. We don't believe that. We believe in we're saved unto good works. And that's a work God begins in us once we're saved. So, thing is, we got to get saved first. So, turning the grace of our God to lasciviousness. Now, what's the next thing they do? Denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So, what are they doing? Preaching law, denying Jesus. All right? These are the people turning the grace of God into lasciviousness, not believers that are living in too much sin. I'm so sick of people twisting verses to bring condemnation to those who shall never come in condemnation. Okay, I will therefore put you in remembrance, though you once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not. All right, it's about believing. And then he mentions all the judgment and the angels that kept not their first estate. This is a warning to the Jewish people, again, just like Hebrews, not to depart from the living God by rejecting Christ. This is not about believers losing salvation or sinning too much, but left their own habitation, has he reserved in everlasting chains into darkness on the judgment of that great day. Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication and going after strange flesh, are set forth an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. Now these people, these false teachers, they are going around and they are wicked men, ungodly men, and they're preaching against the grace of God. They are preaching against the gospel and denying our Lord Jesus Christ. And they are lasciviousness. They are ungodly men. And he's talking about the judgment that's going to come on those people. Likewise, also, these filthy dreamers defile the flesh, despise dominion, and speak evil of dignities. So what do they speak evil of? The grace of God, salvation by grace through the finished work of Jesus Christ. So they speak evil of the crucifixion. They speak evil of the gospel. They speak evil of dignities. This is who he's talking about, okay? Yet Michael the archangel, when contending with the devil, disputed about the body of Moses, durst not bring against him a railing accusation, but said, the Lord rebuke you. So he's saying, let's keep our humility about us when rebuking these people. Leave them to the Lord. He'll take care of it. That's why he's saying Michael didn't bring a railing accusation against Satan himself. He left it to the Lord. All right. But these speak evil of those things which they know not. But what they know naturally as brute beasts, in those things they corrupt themselves. Woe unto them, for they have gone the way of Cain. What did Cain do? Offer his works. Offer his works. And then hated the one that was saved by the blood of the Lamb, his brother, and killed him. That's the way of Cain. Wicked men that accuse and hate those that are saved by the blood. The way of Cain offers works, thinks they're righteous, and hates the people of God. All right? And ran greedily after the error of Balaam for reward. What was that? What did Balaam do? He tried to curse the nation of Israel and was a false prophet for profit, for money. All right? And perished in the gainsaying of Kor. Kor is the one that came against the leadership of God's chosen, that was Moses. All right? So they don't respect God's chosen people either. These are spots in your feast of charity when they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear. Clouds they are without water, carried about of winds, trees whose fruit withereth, without fruit, twice dead plucked up by the roots. Who is these false prophets that deny the Lord Jesus Christ and turn the grace of God into lasciviousness? They go the way of Cain, preaching work salvation, speaking against those that believe in the blood of the Lamb, like righteous Abel. They come against those chosen, like Korah and Moses. And they're false prophets for profit, like Balaam. These are twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Means they die physically and they perish eternally. Twice dead, plucked up by the roots. Okay? So that is what it's talking about, these people. I think you can see it's very clear what that verse is talking about. It is not talking about believers sinning too much. It has nothing at all to do with it. But the letter is to contend for the faith once delivered unto the saints. And it's talking about these false prophets, ungodly men, brute beasts, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. So hopefully you can see it in context so people can stop pulling these things out of context. I said the other night, when you take a verse out of context, you con people. It is a con to take stuff out of context because you're conning them into thinking it says something it doesn't say, and we're not supposed to do that. That's wicked. That's witchcraft. It's to twist. That's what Wicca comes from. The word for wick of a candle means to twist. That's where Wicca came from. It means to twist words. So you have to be very careful to read things in context. With that being said, I hope you guys have a great holiday season. If you celebrate Christmas, do it unto the Lord. If you don't celebrate Christmas, don't do it unto the Lord, because every day is His. I will not be here Wednesday, but I will be here Thursday for the throwdown. And I believe both sisters Lisa will be back with me, the powerhouses, and Brother Dave, a very powerful evangelist. So I hope you guys have a good holiday, and I love you. God bless.